Good morning, and thanks for joining me in these few moments of our virtual worship and reflection. Being in the chapel on my own puts in front of me the COVID reality that we've lived for the better part of this year. And I have to say that I really feel your physical absence in this place where we've regularly gathered as a family community for worship. If you've got your Bible on hand, open it with me as I read a call to worship from selected verses of Psalm 89. And listen carefully to the proclamation of God's love, that the focus of both our worship and our witness is the love of God. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you have established your faithfulness in the heavens itself. The heavens praise your wonders, Lord. Your faithfulness, too, is in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies above can compare with the Lord? Who is like the Lord among the heavenly beings? In the council of the holy ones, God is greatly feared. He's more awesome than all who surround him. Who is like you, Lord God Almighty? You, Lord, are mighty, and your faithfulness surrounds you. Your arm is endowed with power, your hand is strong, and your right hand exalted. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Love and faithfulness go before you. This morning, Lord, we thank you that we experience your love and faithfulness. Help us, Lord, to continue making your love known to others. Amen. Well, this morning, we're reminded that there is one thing that COVID-19 does not and cannot do, and that is separate us from the unfailing love of God. So let's contemplate and worship with the music and gospel arts team as they share with us the truth of his amazing grace, his unfailing love.
Of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. Whoa, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. To order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Sometimes struggled to believe that God can truly love you. I'm aware of my own shortcomings, especially on what I call my ugly days, when I'm not so loving or lovable, and I can be tempted to feel a sense of failure, falling short of God's best for me, that perhaps God can't even love me. But in the 8th chapter of Romans, Paul explains the love of God as the chapter begins with no condemnation, verse 1, and ends with no separation, verse 39. Nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. It's an absolute truth in which our soul can rest and our relationships thrive. St. Augustine wrote that God loves each one of us as if there was only one of us to love. I want to take a look and spend a little bit of time in Romans 8, the last half of the chapter, 18 to verse 39. And I want to encourage you in these days to meditate on the deep love of Jesus Christ. We've just gone through a season of thanksgiving, that we would be overwhelmed by love and gratitude. Even over your lunch hour today, or maybe this evening, that you take some time to read this chapter through again. Absorb its truths. COVID has greatly impacted the globe and nations of the world. Put that in a little bit more closely. It's deeply affected our lives and those around us, our work, our employment, economics, health, and for some, it has even taken life itself. The losses have been immense, and we can be left questioning God's love in the midst of such days. Do your circumstances ever cause you to question God's love for you? In Romans 8, we see that Paul suffered greatly through beatings, imprisonment, many other hardships. But he says that the suffering, the hard times, can't compare to the glory that he will one day see. There's no comparison between the present hard times and the coming good times. Verse 18, the message. Paul uses the analogy of a pregnancy. You are feeling the pains of labor. While we're waiting, we have the first fruits of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a down payment, guaranteeing what is to come, the future glory. One day, the whole of creation will be liberated. Here and now, your body may be groaning as we age or as we're affected by disease. But one day, it will be totally healed, restored. Our resurrection won't only be spiritual, it will be physical. And so we wait eagerly for the redemption of our bodies. As we wait, expectancy and joyful anticipation deepen. Well, meanwhile, the moment that we can get tired in the waiting, in the difficulty, God's Spirit is right alongside helping you and I. And if we don't know how or what to pray, it doesn't matter. The Holy Spirit does our praying in and for us, making prayers out of our wordless sighs, our aching groans. He knows us far better than we know ourselves. He knows our condition, and he keeps us present before God. That's why we can be so sure that in every detail of our lives, of God's love, it's worked together into something good. Life is not the random mess that sometimes it appears to be or we feel it is. We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose. In every detail of your life, God is at work. All things include even our mistakes. God will take even our errors, my errors, and work them out for the good as we submit and abide in him. If everything works out for the good of those who love him supremely, the cross demonstrates that just as God took the very worst event in history and turned it into the very best, he can take the very worst things in our lives and use them for good. Well, this applies to all Christians, this promise. And he elaborates in verse 29 to 30. You are foreknown, predestined, called, justified, glorified. These first four events have happened, but glorification is a future event. However, Paul uses that same past tense for all of them. You are glorified. This use of the aorist or completed tense shows that Paul has certainty, a confidence about the future. Listen to verses 29 to 30 of the message. God knew what he was doing from the very beginning. He decided from the onset to shape the lives of those who love him along the same lines as the life of his son. The son stands first in line of humanity he restored. He sees the original and the intended shape of our lives there in him. After God made that decision of what his children should be like, he followed it up by calling people by name. And after he called them by name, he set them on a solid basis with himself. And then after getting them established, he stayed with them to the end, gloriously completing what he had begun. This is astonishing, perhaps the most daring statement in faith in the whole New Testament. It speaks of the security we have in this love, this amazing love. The security of a Christian is solid ground, the unwavering love of God. The sure foundation is deeper than all our circumstances and feelings as we abide faithfully in him. Well, how can you be sure of God's love? Paul poses five really significant questions to us as we're thinking about this. One, with God on your side like this, how can you lose? If God is for us, who can be against us? If God is for you, what others think is not so important. You are set free from the fear of people, of caring, of putting too much stock in what others think. Two, if God didn't hesitate to put everything on the line for us, embracing our condition, exposing himself to the worst by sending his own son, is there anything else he wouldn't gladly and freely do for us? Verse 32 reminds us that he did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us. And how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Three, who would dare tangle with God by messing with one of God's own? Who would dare even point a finger or put another way? Who is going to dare to prosecute you? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? Verse 33. Four, if God is the judge and Jesus your defense counselor, how can prosecution succeed? It is God who justifies. Who then can condemn? Jesus, our defense lawyer. He's supremely qualified. Jesus Christ, who died, has already served the sentence for us. He was raised to life by God. He is praying for us. He is in the presence of God at this very moment, sticking up for us. Jesus never stops praying for us. Five, how can anyone drive a wedge between you and Christ's love? You can be separated from friends and family by circumstances. And how many of us have experienced this reality in COVID? Or even death. But who will separate us from the love of Christ Jesus? Verse 35. This doesn't mean that life is easy. Scripture tells us that in this life we will have trouble. It's almost a guarantee. Hard times, hatred, hunger, homelessness, bullying, threats, backstabbing. But not even the worst sin lists in Scripture. None of this phases us because of Jesus' love. In the midst of every difficulty, we can cling to and rely on God's amazing love for you and I. Well, finally, at the end of this eighth chapter, from verses 35 to 39, Paul has a really long list, 17 possibilities involving calamities of life, super huge agencies, time, space. His list includes absolutely every possible challenge and trouble that you and I could face. And he concludes that he is totally convinced that nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord, verse 39. As Isaac Watts wrote, "Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all." Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your amazing and unfailing love. Thank you for the truth of your word, that in all things you are working together for the good in our lives, that absolutely nothing can separate us from your love. And as we're about our work and your mission today, may your power and transforming love be evident in us. And we ask this in Jesus' name and by the power of his love. Amen. As we sign off, let the words and the truth of this next song be our joy and our benediction today. Jesus Messiah, whose love is truly amazing. God bless you.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out, oh, for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing, Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sin, from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. All our hope is in you, all our hope is in you, all the glory. Messiah, name above all names. blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.